Observability? Monitoring? Aren't they the same thing? That's what a lot of people think, but we're going to debunk that myth and five others today in this video. Let's get to it. Myth number one, just a name. What do I mean by that? I'm actually talking about how a lot of people think that there's not much difference between application performance monitoring and observability. But the truth is, it's that they're built for two completely different problem sets. Application performance monitoring, or APM, was built around the concept of seeing inside runtimes. Now, things like Java or .NET. But the reason it works for APM is because in the world of runtimes, especially monolithic runtimes, all your backend systems are tied to that same runtime. And all your front-end requests are coming in to that same runtime. So if you have visibility here, then you can see everything that's going on in your system. But observability is built for modern applications that are built on top of microservices environments with much more complex systems. And while there are some runtimes that might be in those systems, that's not enough for you to understand exactly what's going on throughout the entire microservice application. So the only way to really do that is with observability, which has the ability to monitor all parts of the system, even going back to your backend systems like your mainframes, so that you see a full picture of everything that's going on in the world of your applications. Well, that was myth number one. Now let's take a look at myth number two, loglove. What's loglove? Loglove is actually referring to something I found out a few years ago from an analyst who I was talking to. And he asked me if I had heard about this situation where people were taking their metrics, traces, and logs, which everyone thinks of as observability, and not doing any monitoring, or rather just writing all that information into log files, and when a problem occurred, going to the logs to solve the problem. This isn't just a myth. This is an actual anti-pattern. An anti-pattern is something that seems like it's a good idea, but it's actually the exact opposite result. And in this case, the exact opposite result can be destructive to your environment, to your applications, to your business. Let me explain why. If you're not monitoring, that is looking at all the different pieces of your environment, plus seeing how your end users are being affected by monitoring their performance as well, and doing this in real time as it's happening, then when you find out there's a problem, say through a trouble ticket, that means that you're already too late to help yourself. But by monitoring, you have the ability to catch things before they happen. And the other nice thing is by tying all the monitoring pieces together with your log information that you do have, you actually speed up your troubleshooting. So not only do you have the chance to get in front of incidents before they impact your users, but when an incident does occur, you have the ability to solve it much faster. So when I think of MTL in the world of monitoring versus logging, I just like to put a little two on the M for metrics, monitoring, traces, and logs. Now that we've looked at two myths, let's look at myth number three, sticker shock. What are we talking about? You probably want to hear about pricing and costs for observability tools. And it's something that we should look at because the reality is that observability tools can be expensive, but they don't have to be expensive. Let me explain why. There is one way of pricing where everything, all the features that you get and all the things that you do are inclusive and forecastable and known, such as charging per host in your environment. This allows you to have a very steady price quarter by quarter, year by year, based on the number of things that you're actually monitoring. But there is another way that some observability solutions and monitoring solutions charge, and that is to charge you for other things around the system, such as the number of applications that you're running, or maybe the number of users that you have using your product that's actually using the observability tool themselves. Maybe they're just looking at the amount of data that you're sending through the system. They might even charge you just for debugging. And what happens when this comes in is you don't know what's going to happen ahead of time. So you're going along at a fair clip, and then one or more of these things happen, and you end up with a quarterly surprise charge. How big is that surprise charge going to be? There's evidence out in the marketplace that it could be $50 million or more. So when you're looking at your observability solutions, you have to keep this myth in mind, not because it's definitely going to be there, but because there's ways around it. But you want to be looking for solutions that have all-inclusive pricing and have a fair and forecastable way of giving you that price. Okay, we're halfway through the myths. Now we're about to talk about myth number four. Who, me? That sounds really weird. Let's talk about it. A lot of people think that observability is built to be used only by site reliability engineers or SREs. But the situation with modern applications, and this is actually something that goes beyond traditional monitoring capabilities, is that observability allows us to give the information from the systems to the individual people and organizations that need it. So for example, you could get end user information to your marketing team. You can get performance of different runtimes to your development organization. You can look at the system as a whole sent to your DevOps team, or of course your SRE team, and other IT personnel that need to see what's going on. You can even include your business users and give them the information they need. The fact is that observability takes all the data that in traditional monitoring is put just through your ops power users and makes it democratized, giving everyone a view of the data that they need so that they can do their job as an application stakeholder. Now we've made it to myth number five. Pick favorites. What do you mean by that, Chris? Well, we've talked about the fact that we have all kinds of ways of pricing things and observability tools, but one of the things that happens is that it takes a lot of effort to get traditional monitoring tools working. So while a lot of organizations have anywhere from 8 to maybe 20 or even hundreds of applications, the truth is that traditional monitoring tools require way too much effort and work and cost to give you all this information. So you usually have to draw a line and pick your favorite applications that you're going to monitor, and the rest don't get any monitoring at all. Why do I not like this? I don't like this because if you have an application, it's important to somebody. Or as I like to say, every application is important to somebody. And that means that there are stakeholders of those applications, including business owners and application owners and developers, that need the information that comes from observability. You shouldn't have to pick. And that's why observability gives you this broader, better view of the entire systems, as opposed to making you pick just a few applications, just in case. Okay, we're at the last myth. Myth number six, DIY. The truth of the matter is, you can build monitoring yourself, but you shouldn't build monitoring yourself. Let me explain why. When you add monitoring to all the pieces you have to do, plus when you add the idea of being able to measure everything to the front end, oh, and don't forget, you need to detect changes like when a service disappears, or maybe when a new service appears within the system. Doing all that manually requires you to slow things down. And as you're trying to accelerate your development, as you're trying to get better as an IT organization, have better performing applications, slowing things down is a bad idea. In fact, it leads to lower quality applications. You want to speed things up, and the only way to speed things up is to automate. And that's why you want to look for an observability solution that automates things, that automates discovery, that automates mapping the system, that automates monitoring end users, and does that for all the different users that you're going to bring into place across all the different applications that you have to monitor and can see fully across the entire system and trace everything you need to trace. You need to do this automatically or else you're going to slow down your development systems and ultimately result in lower quality applications and unhappy customers. And that's not what we want. So look for automation and stay away from manual observability. Thanks for watching. Before you leave, make sure you hit like and subscribe.